I really don't know what to talk about. So you have 30 minutes?
Great. Thank you all for coming. Thanks to the organizers for having me and putting all this together. I'm excited to be here. Great. All right. I want to pass, but I don't want to study. I want to eat pizza, but I don't want heartburn. I want to see the concert tonight, but I don't want to take the drive. These are pairs of strongly conflicting desire descriptions. And they're predicted to be incompatible by all of the standard semantics for want. All right, be a little more precise. Say that A wants B and A wants Q conflict just in case A believes that P will be true only if Q is not. So you want two things you believe you can't get both. That's when you have conflicting desires, and when we ascribe those desires to you, you get conflicting desire descriptions. A strongly conflicting desire, strongly conflicting desire descriptions are stronger than that. We say that A wants P and A wants Q strongly conflict when A believes that P, if and only if, not just only if. So conflicting desires and conflicting desire descriptions are a little more common. It happens all the time. You know, you want to do things, you can't do both. You want to do one thing, but it has an undesirable feature, so you don't want to do that. Strongly conflicting desires are a little less common, but we still have them. And it's that class, sort of this narrower class of strongly conflicting desire descriptions, that are a problem for all of the semantics. So it's those that I'm going to focus on. Good. All right, so we'll set up a case. Al's parents are deciding whether or not to go to a Who concert tonight. Al loves the Who, favorite band, but in order to get to the concert, they've got to go on this like 4 or 5 hour drive. And Al gets really car sick. Al is just begging his parents not to go, kicking and screaming. Al's a little kid. Okay. Al wants to see the concert, but he doesn't want to take the drive. Seems good in these cases, both true. And in this case, these desire descriptions strongly conflict because Al believes that if he gets in the car to go to the concert, he's gonna see the concert. His parents are just gonna put him there. And he also knows that his only shot at seeing the concert is taking the drive. So he believes that he'll see the concert if and only if he takes the drive, which means that wanting to go to the concert and wanting to not take the drive strongly conflict. So I said that these two descriptions and strongly conflicting desire descriptions in general are predicted to be incompatible by all of the standard semantics. These semantics form a class. They treat want like a modal, and in particular like a necessity modal. So you've got some set of worlds, and you ask whether certain of them are best or preferred between them. So this is the class of semantics that I'm interested in. And I can't sort of go through every style that semantics in this talk and say, this one makes them incompatible, this one makes them incompatible, this one makes them incompatible. So instead, I'm just going to look at a certain kind of semantics for desire descriptions, a best world semantics. So this is sort of like the orthodox semantics for necessity modals, and in particular, deontic modals. As I present the semantics, it might seem sort of like unfamiliar, it might seem like it has some problems, and that's because it does have problems. For example, it doesn't deal with risk very well. It doesn't deal with the gradability of desire. You can want one thing more than another. But these issues are orthogonal to the problem, because the problem applies also to semantics that can account for these facts. Okay, so just looking at the outline here, what we're going to do is we're going to see this problem with the best world semantics. And the way that the problem generates, we can think of it by breaking sort of these standard accounts from want, for want into three parts. One, you've sort of got the core semantics. And then you have to say, what are the worlds under consideration? I said that these semantics, you've got some set of worlds, and then you've got some preference ranking over them. So we derive the incompatibility by taking the semantics that has this form and then making two standard assumptions about what the set of worlds is and what the preference relation is, what the ranking is. So these are the two standard constraints. And people have proposed to drop one or the other. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at both of these different ways of dropping them. I'm going to say they don't work. And then I'm going to diagnose the problem at the end. And the problem is basically like these semantics are not capturing properly the way that what we desire depends on what we believe. And this failure to capture that fact is in and of itself interesting, because although I'm concerned with the semantics, this is a problem for understanding desire and belief itself, how these two things interact. So that's something to kind of keep in mind as I'm moving through here, that I am doing at this at the level of the semantics, because using the semantics allows us to think about how want might be context sensitive, for example. So it allows us a little more maneuverability to solve this apparent problem. But this is itself a problem for analyzing desire itself. Okay, good. All right, so we've got a case study of the problem, best world semantics, given the two constraints. So like I said, the form of these semantics, and in particular the best world semantics, comes in two pieces. We've got a set of worlds, which is the modal base. Now, if you're familiar with sort of the terminology behind this style of semantics, the classic Kratzer semantics, there's a little more complication here, but I'm going to sort of gloss over that. Not important to see the problem. So we've got the modal base, which is a set of worlds, and then we've got the ordering source, which is, induces a ranking on this set of worlds. And these two components combine together to give us like the basic form of the semantics. And that form is this. Just on the handout, form of the semantics, sorry, we'll move now to section two. So the form of the semantics is that A wants P is true, just in case P is true in all of the best worlds in the modal base as ranked by the ordering source. So we take the modal base, the set of worlds, we take the ordering source ranking on those worlds, and then we ask, among the best worlds there, is P true in all of them? And if so, then it's true that A wants P. Okay, that is super schematic. In order to know what we're saying, we need to know what the modal base and the ordering source are. This is just the form of the semantics that we can also use, for example, for deontic modals. So this is where these two standard constraints come in. They're constraints on the modal base and on the ordering source. So what is the modal base for a desire description? We can think more generally about what it is to desire something. Well, it looks like what we desire, whether we stand in the desire in relation to some proposition, depends upon what we believe that thing will be like. I want to eat sushi. But I also believe that I'm not going to be sentenced to death if I'm caught eating sushi. Worlds where it's illegal to eat sushi are just irrelevant to my desire to eat sushi. They just don't figure into my attitude towards sushi. Quote from Bob Stallnaker, sort of along these lines. He says, wanting something is preferring it to certain relevant alternatives. Those alternatives being what the agent believes will come about if she does not get what she wants. So we can translate this thought into our semantics by saying that the modal base, and this is the belief-based modal constraint, is the agent's belief set, which is the set of all worlds compatible with what she believes. So this is the modal base constraint. The modal base for A wants P is A's belief set. Now, a quick caveat here, which is that we want things all the time that we believe can't happen. I want to play in the NBA. I know that that won't happen. There are no worlds compatible with my beliefs in which I play in the NBA. So it can't be that in all of the best worlds compatible with my beliefs, I play in the NBA. So this semantics, as stated, this constraint is not going to be able to handle those cases. We're going to need something else. But we don't have to decide what's going on in those cases. And in fact, I think even in those cases, we're still going to get things like strongly conflicting desires. Description. So, for example, I want to play in the NBA, but I'm a very modest person, so I don't want to be famous. But, I mean, there's no chance I'm going to be famous anyway. I think that's maybe the only way it could possibly happen. So we're still going to get these problems even in these other cases that where we believe something is impossible. But we'll just set those to the side and focus on cases where the agent treats as possible the proposition that we're ascribing the desired relation to her. All right, good. What is the ordering source? Well, just to sort of catch us up to where we are, we can sort of fill in the blank for what we had before. So now we have A wants P is true, just in case. All of the best worlds, P is true in all of the best worlds in A's belief set as ranked by the ordering source. So now we need to say what the ordering source is. Well, on what basis are we going to rank worlds when trying to evaluate desire ascriptions? Well, pretty obviously on the basis of what the agent desires. It'd be crazy to evaluate a desire ascription to me based on what LeBron James wants. We're very different people. So in order to sort of give truth conditions for what I want, we have to ask, what do I desire? Not what does somebody else desire? Okay, so that much nobody has been crazy enough to dispute, at least yet. But there's a further constraint, there's a further assumption that is made, which is that the ordering source doesn't just rank worlds on the basis of what the agent desires. The ordering source ranks worlds based on what the agent's total desire state, or in some sense, what the agent desires full stop. So you might think that we have desires that we desire things in one respect or another. Like I want to go to the concert insofar as I like to have fun. I don't want to take the drive insofar as I don't like getting sick. But the standard assumption is that that's not the way that the truth conditions for desire ascriptions work. We look at the agent's total desire state and we rank worlds on that basis. That assumption is going to be challenged just like the assumption about the modal-based constraint. All right, so turning to the next page here, we can fill in this form of the semantics now with our two constraints. So we say that A wants P is true just in case P is true in all of the best worlds in A's belief set as ranked by A's total desire state. One way to think of this is just that A wants P is true just in case among the possibilities that A thinks might come about, her most favored are those where P attains. Makes sense. Okay, but these truth conditions predict that 1 and 2 are incompatible. Why? Why? Well, if Al wants to see the concert is true, then all of the best worlds in the modal base, all the best worlds in his belief set are ones where he sees the concert. And if Al doesn't want to take the drive is true, then all of those worlds are also worlds. All of those best worlds are also worlds where he doesn't take the drive. But he believes he'll see the concert just in case he takes the drive. He treats it as a doxastic impossibility that he both sees the concert and doesn't take the drive, which is to say there are no worlds in his belief set where he both sees the concert and doesn't take the drive. So the truth conditions say, if these two sentences are true, then in all of the best worlds in his belief set, he both sees the concert and takes the drive, but there are no such worlds in his belief set. And this actually amounts to a contradiction if we make some sort of very minimal assumptions that are sort of baked into the semantics. All right. So what's the lesson here? Well, one lesson you might take away is that the agent's beliefs are influencing the truth conditions too much. It does seem right to say that what we want depends upon what we think that thing would be like. But by using the agent's belief set, we exclude the possibility that it looks like we're interested in. One where Al Wolf sees the concert and doesn't take the drive. That's a classic impossibility. So the agent's beliefs are like crowding out what the semantics need to make both descriptions true. Okay. So there are two obvious moves to make in response to this problem. One, drop the ordering source constraint. Two, drop the modal base constraint. And both of these things have been proposed. So I already floated this idea, we're now moving on to section three in the handout, that maybe our desires conflict because we have conflicting values in some sense. So relative to the value of hearing good music, Al wants to see the concert. Relative to the value of avoiding sickness, Al doesn't want to take the drive. And we could encode this thought in our semantics by allowing the ordering source to rank worlds not just on the basis of the agent's total desire state, but on the basis of part of the agent's desire state, what the agent desires in some respect to the other, and what the agent desires with respect to some value and not the other. So that's the variable partial desire ordering source constraint, which is that the ordering source for A1's P may just represent part of A's desire state, may just represent what he values in some respect or other. All right, so take one ordering source, ordering source one. This represents Al's value of hearing good music. What that means is that it ranks worlds in his belief set best where he sees the concert. Those are the worlds where he hears good music. So with respect to ordering source one, all of the best worlds in Al's belief set are ones where he sees the concert. So with respect to ordering source one, Al wants to see the concert is true. And we see the similar thing with another ordering source two, which represents Al's value or Al's desire to avoid sickness. Al avoids sickness in all the worlds in his belief set where he doesn't take the drive. He's just going to sit at home. He's going to feel fine. So in all of the worlds in Al's belief set where he doesn't take the drive, he avoids sickness. So in all of the best worlds, as ranked by the avoiding sickness ordering source, he doesn't take the drive, which means that Al doesn't want to take the drive is true with respect to the avoiding sickness ordering source, which I'm calling ordering source two. Okay. So the variable partial desire ordering source constraint works. It allows conflicting desire descriptions to be compatible. And the way that it does that is by positing extra ordering sources. Extra ordering sources give us extra true readings. The problem is that these extra ordering sources give us too many true readings. We get overgeneration. So we're going to predict, because we have extra ordering sources, that sentences that are false are in fact. So we're going to predict that sentences are true when in fact they're false. All right. So remember that Al is like freaking out. He's just begging to not take the drive. He really, really does not want to go. So intuitively, this case, Al wants to take the drive, has no true reading. It's just the sentence is false. It might be that in a case where the drive was worth it for Al, it would be both true that he wants to take the drive and that he doesn't want to take the drive. He might be complaining about the fact that he has to go on the drive, saying, I don't want to do it, I don't want to do it. But when push comes to shove, his parent says, are you getting in the car? He might say yes, I want to take the drive. Because in that case, it's worth it. Feeling sick, you know, for however long is worth whatever fun he could get by seeing the concert. But that's not this case. The case, as we've set it up, is one where the drive is not worth it for Al. He's just begging not to go. So it's just not true in any sense that he wants to take the drive. That's the claim. Okay, but remember, we've got this ordering source. Ordering source one. And it ranks the drive worlds, sorry, it ranks the concert world best in Al's belief set. Because ordering source one promotes the value of hearing good music. Al believes, though, that he'll see the concert if and only if he takes the drive, which means that the concert worlds in his belief set are coextensive with the drive worlds in his belief set. So any ordering source that ranks concert worlds in his belief set best thereby ranks drive worlds in his belief set best. Okay, what does that mean? Well, that means that Al wants to take the drive is true with respect to ordering source one because it ranks drive worlds best in his belief set. So we've overgenerated. We've predicted that three, Al wants to take the drive, has a true reading here when it in fact doesn't. Okay, this doesn't just like totally like close the book on the variable ordering source constraint. The variable ordering source constraint is a form of contextualism. Basically it says, when you're evaluating a sentence, you might evaluate it with respect to this contextual parameter, this ordering source. When you're evaluating a different sentence, you might get it with respect to a different contextual parameter, a different ordering source. As we know, contextualist views about whatever, about knowledge, they've got flexibility. They can say, okay, you can't hear this true reading. Well, that's because, let me tell you a story about what happens, some sort of context shift. And so you can never like truly utter the sentence or something. So the variable ordering source view kind of has some maneuverability, and I can tell you a little bit later why I think that maneuverability isn't going to get it what it wants. But this is a sort of like a knockdown argument against the view. Just checking the time here, not looking at my text. Okay. All right, what's the lesson here? Was that the agent's beliefs are still influencing the truth conditions too much. We've still got the belief set as the modal base. And once we have the belief set as the modal base, the ordering source can't distinguish the concert from the drive. Because within the modal base, within his belief set, the concert is coextensive with the drive. So the natural move, well, the problem then is just with the modal base. We can't set the modal base to be the belief set. So let's scrap that. This is section four. Do we want to drop the belief base modal base constraint? Pretty simple idea. You just say, here's the beyond belief modal base constraint. The modal base for A1's P can contain worlds outside of the belief set. The belief set was what was preventing two strongly conflicting desire descriptions from being compatible. So once you let in worlds outside of the belief set, that structural obstacle is gone. So in principle, there's really just no problem at all. But just to say that there is in principle no problem isn't yet to give a view. In order to make predictions about which sentences are true, we have to say which worlds are in the modal base. Otherwise, we're just, it's not a semantics at all. We're not tracking truth conditions. We're just saying this is possible. So we need to answer the question, which worlds are in the modal base for which sentences, in which context? Only one person has answered this question, Vialta. Her view is contrastive. So she says, you don't just sort of want P full stop, you want P in comparison to Q and R. And what those contrast classes can vary by context. So her view is that if P, Q, and R make up the contrast class for evaluating A1's P, then the modal base is just every world where P is true, every world where Q is true, every world where R is true, the union of those propositions. Okay, the problem with this view is that it just makes it way too hard for desire descriptions, conflicting or not, to be compatible. There's just way too many worlds in the modal base. So think about what this view says for Al wants to see the concert. What it requires, okay, and then let's just set the contrast class to sort of be the default contrast class. He wants to see, he sees the concert, he doesn't see the concert. So what is the modal base? Well, it's every world where he sees the concert and every world where he doesn't see the concert. And so what Vialta is saying is, If it's true that he wants to see the concert, then all of the best worlds in this set are ones where he sees the concert. But that's just crazy. Because there are all sorts of worlds out there where amazing things happen and he doesn't see the concert. There are worlds where the Who just play in his living room. There are worlds where Lennon and Harrison are resurrected from the dead, the Beatles reunite, and they play in his living room. These worlds are fantastic. They're certainly just as good as worlds where he goes to the concert and sees the Who perform. So it just can't be that these worlds are best within this modal base. And in general, we can see that this is just a bad strategy for giving truth conditions for desire descriptions. There are so many ways for any given proposition to come about that once we look at all of them, we just can't expect that all of the best ones will be P ones. All of the best ones will be ones where the prejacent of the desire description is true. Again, I want to point out that the lesson here again has to do with the way that the agent's beliefs are interacting with the desires. The way that we motivated the modal base belief set constraint in the first place, the one that Vialta is rejecting, is with this case of sushi, where these sort of doxastically outrageous worlds, where I'm in prison for eating sushi, have nothing to do with my desire for eating sushi. So we need the modal base to be the belief set. That was the thought. We've got a similar thing going on here. Al's attitude towards going to the concert just has nothing to do with worlds where the Beatles are resurrected and play in his living room. Those worlds are just irrelevant to his desire to see the concert. So of course, if we put those worlds in the modal base, we're gonna make the wrong predictions. It's just not gonna work. All right, running out of time here a little bit. Let's move to page three. So just gonna put forward here one other answer to the question, which worlds are in the modal base for a given desire description. If we're gonna allow worlds in that aren't in the belief set, which worlds are we gonna allow in? So here's another answer to that question. What was the problem before? Well, it was that we needed the best worlds to be ones where Al both saw the concert and didn't take the drive. But there weren't any worlds like that in the belief set. Here's a modal base, just take his belief set, add some worlds like that. You make both descriptions true, you're done. All right, so again, that works. We've sort of removed the structural obstacle, and in fact, we've said which worlds are in this modal base. There's a problem, though, which is that we haven't sort of given a principle by which we get to do this. We just sort of said, well, these descriptions are true, and we need these worlds to be in the modal base, so throw them in there. If we don't give a principle by which to say these worlds get in, but those don't, we're again gonna overgenerate. So let's take a different case. Jo is in the hospital, she's sick. She believes that she can't be cured, the doctors disagree. They might be giving her antibiotics tonight, whether she wants antibiotics or not. If it were up to her, she would choose not to have them. She believes she can't be cured. So intuitively the sentence for Jo wants to be in antibiotics, that's false. It has no true reading here. But let's, again, make a new modal base. Just take Jo's belief set and add some worlds where she's given antibiotics and is cured. In those worlds, those are the best worlds in the belief set. She's cured, that's fantastic. So in all of the best worlds in this new modal base, she's given antibiotics. So we predict that it's true that she wants to be given antibiotics. So there's this open question. Maybe there's a way to distinguish Al's belief set plus worlds where he takes, or sorry, where he, maybe there's a way to prevent overgeneration. Maybe there's a way to distinguish the modal base that's Al's belief set plus worlds where he sees the concert but doesn't take the drive from Jo's belief set, plus worlds where she is cured by antibiotics. But without such an answer, we're going to overgenerate. And again, I want to suggest that the reason we're going to overgenerate is that these worlds outside of the belief set have nothing to do with the agent's desires. Jo's attitude towards antibiotics, she doesn't want to take them, is predicated on the fact that she cannot be cured by them. So if we add in worlds where she's cured by them, of course we're going to mess up. Of course we're going to give the wrong truth conditions for desire descriptions. And in general, I think that this really is a very deep problem for any view that allows in worlds outside of the belief set. Just that what we want is sensitive to what we believe. So when you bring in doxastic impossibilities, you're going to go wrong. All right. So we're just going to, there are two different other ways on the handout here that I have of trying to fill in the modal beyond belief set modal-based constraint. We can save those for Q&A. So we'll just close here with a diagnosis. And it's sort of what I've been saying all along. If we have the beliefs modal-based constraint, the agent's beliefs are too influential because we can't distinguish propositions that the agent believes to be coextensive. We can't distinguish the concert from the drive. But without the belief modal-based constraint, the truth conditions are looking at worlds that are irrelevant to what we desire. So it looks like either way we go, we're not properly capturing the way that what we desire depends on what we believe. Thank you.
Thanks, Milo. Now our very own Daniel Garibay is gonna reply.
Okay. Thank you very much. I really like your paper.
Thanks.
For my comments, I'm gonna focus on three things. I'm gonna start with the easy questions. His paper is about a problem for the traditional count of desire descriptions and the most natural ways to resolve it. So here are some quotes from your paper to illustrate that. But my first doubt is what do you believe is the strength of your conclusion? Because you may want to say that the traditional account should be abandoned, or you may want to say that it has big problems, but it's compatible with someone arriving and showing us a solution. So that's my first question. If you want to hold something really strong, or just that this account has some problems. So these are my questions. Do you believe the theory should be abandoned? If you believe it should be abandoned, do you have an alternative in mind? Or if you believe it can be fixed, have you something in mind about it? Now, my second point is, you say that there is, let's say, another problem. The problem is between when our desires oppose our beliefs. But you believe that your characterization of the problem, when you say that the problem is that the count cannot give us the right prediction we have when we have opposing desires, you believe that this formulation is better because we will have the problem of opposing desires even if we deal with the other problem. And I don't know if that's true. I actually believe that the core problem is between conflict between beliefs and desires. So, why do I believe this? Let's just look at an example. Let's say that, taking one of your examples, let's say Jo wants to get cured, but she believes she can't get cured. It's very natural that she wants to get cured even if she believes she can. But the traditional account, without any modifications, predicts that Joe's desire is false, because in our model base, we don't have any world where Joe is cured. So it doesn't matter how you order those worlds, you don't have the world that represents Joe's desire. Okay, now, why do I believe that this is a better way to let's say, point at the problem from the account. I believe it's a better way to put it in this way, because a solution to this problem is a solution to the problem of opposing desires, but not the other way. Why do I say this? One of the solutions you objected is the solution you call the multiple ordering sorts. The multiple ordering sorts has problems that you point out, but let's say that it doesn't have the problem of opposing desires. But the multiple ordering sorts view doesn't solve the problem between the conflict between desires and beliefs. That what I'm saying is that it doesn't matter what the other source you take if you don't have the word that represents the desire. If you solve the problem between conflict between desires and belief, you solve the problem between, let's say, the opposing desires. If you are worlds where you can have what you believe, where you have what you believe you cannot have, you can, let's say, solve both. So that's why I believe this way of putting the problem points out the problem better. And also, the other thing I want to say is that if you put the problem this way, you don't have to say anything about the solutions with the other source. It's immediately you know that those accounts are going to fail, because it doesn't matter how you order them, you need more words. So you don't need extra objections. Okay, so, I believe that this suggests that the problem is that the account predicts one don't desire what one believes one cannot have. Now, of course, you also believe that the solutions that modify the model-based constraint have problems, and that's my final point. According to you, the problem with putting more worlds in the model base is that it allows to introduce irrelevant worlds. And irrelevant worlds in the model base are going to give us wrong predictions. We don't want. So, well, these two things are the things that I believe we'll learn from this talk. The first thing that I believe we'll learn from you is that if the model base is too small, then we have the problem of opposing desires, or the conflict between desires and belief problem. But the other thing that I believe we'll learn from your talk is that if the model base is too big, too many desired ascriptions come out false. That is the problem with Pilarov's constraint. So then here is an illustration from your objection is that, well, we have these two desires. Al wants to see the counter, but Al wants not to take the long drive. And if the model base is the belief set, then we cannot have both. We would like the model base to be A1. We would like the model base be a set where there are worlds where Al see the concert and doesn't take it right. And we don't want the model base to be A2. We don't want to be worlds where the hoop performs in Al's living room, because those worlds are irrelevant. So we want the right middle between those. And we have that. And this is what we want. We want to reject that A2 is the model base, because in your worlds, it doesn't capture how what we decide depends on what we believe. If the model base is too big, it doesn't reflect that. Now, it seems so that we want that as beliefs should exclude worlds in A2, but we want that they shouldn't exclude worlds in A1, because if they do, we have a model base that is too small. So it seems that we want to add worlds with weak believe kind of thing, and we want to exclude words which we believe we cannot think. We think that we want too much. And so finally, can we get it? I believe that this time maybe we can. And I want to make just a small suggestion, it's not to develop it, but I'm going to suggest something. You say that there are worlds worlds that are irrelevant to our desires. And I believe in the same way that worlds are irrelevant to our desires, some beliefs are irrelevant to our desires. Example, as believe that the who won't perform in his living room is relevant for his desire to see them in the concert. He wants to see them in the concert because he believes he cannot have them in his living room. But as believe that he'll see the concert only if he takes the ride, the ride is irrelevant for his desires to see them in the concert. Again, as believe that he sees the concert only if he takes the ride, is irrelevant for his desire to see them in the concert without taking the ride, because he desires that in spite of his belief that he cannot have it. So my suggestion is relevant beliefs determine which words are relevant. Those are the beliefs that are going to, let's say, take out the relevant words. But other beliefs, we can not use it to exclude words. And that's all my thought. Thanks.
All right, thank you so much. That was fantastic. So you asked at the beginning, do I have a positive proposal? Yes, this is my positive proposal. But I do think that to make this precise, we actually can't, the possibilities in the modal base can't be worlds. What we need is something coarser grain possibility. That's the best way to make this notion precise. And I can try to explain that in the Q&A if we like. It takes a little while, but I want to talk a little bit more about the other things you've said. But I think that's dead on. I think that basically what it is to sort of want things from our desire, what it is to want things in a conflicting way is to want things, considering some things and ignoring others. So the basic thought is like considering what the concert would be like, but ignoring what it would take to get to the concert, Al wants to see the concert. And considering what the drive would be like, but ignoring what he could get at the concert, Al doesn't want to take the drive. And the way that we make that precise is we say that, well, what is it to consider or ignore something? Well, it's basically for certain beliefs to factor in and for other beliefs to not. That's the idea, yeah. The reason that I don't think we can do it in a world's framework, the reason I think we need coarser possibilities, I think we can get at, if we look again at the slide with the spheres. What time did we?
We have like 7 minutes.
Okay, so this is right. What we want is to find a middle ground between worlds like these and worlds like these. So if we just have these, the agent's beliefs will be too influential, but if we get these sort of super outrageous ones, they won't be influential enough. The problem is, I don't think there is a good way to distinguish these worlds from other worlds that make us, that give unacceptable predictions. All right, so here let's think about why. So we've got the case with Joe and the antibiotics. So if we add worlds to the modal base where Joe is cured by being given antibiotics, we're going to predict that she wants to be in antibiotics, and that's wrong. So what we're going to need is another sphere that allows these worlds, worlds where Halsey is the concert and doesn't take the drive, but disallows worlds where Joe is given antibiotics and is cured, right? Because we're using these spheres to get some predictions and not others. So here's, I think, but again, we need a principled reason why. This is exactly the right structure. We need these spheres, but we need to say why this sphere and not the other. So here is the thought on the handout, the fourth bullet point, the last bullet point before lesson on page 3. Basically, here's an attempt at trying to distinguish these worlds from these worlds. So he said that the belief set is the set of worlds compatible with what the agent believes. Here's another way to think of that. The belief set is the set of worlds that the agent thinks are viable candidates for actuality. The agent thinks, yeah, this might be the world that I'm in. This might be the world that I'm in. And every world outside of the belief set is an unviable candidate for actuality. That's a world that the agent looks at and says, no, not going to happen. Nonetheless, certain worlds outside the belief set are less viable candidates for actuality than others, even though they're both unviable. This world is a terrible candidate for actuality. It's just crazy, at least as far as Hal is concerned. But this world doesn't look so crazy. So this world is a more viable candidate for actuality than this one. So that distinguishes these two spheres. If we've got this principle that basically says, what's the motive ace for a desire ascription? Well, it's the worlds that the agent thinks aren't too unviable. It's the worlds that are sort of like viable enough. So these worlds get thrown out, and these worlds stay in like we wanted. But remember, we didn't just want to distinguish these worlds from these worlds. We also wanted to distinguish worlds where Al sees the concert and doesn't take the drive from worlds where Joe is given antibiotics and is cured. If we've got a modal base with those worlds, we're also going to mess up. The problem is that this criterion, the viability criterion, can't distinguish these cases. Here's another way to think about what viability looks like. Al would be way more surprised to learn that the WHO were going to perform in his living room than he would be to learn that he could see the concert without taking the drive. If his parents said, oh, the WHO are actually performing, you know, at the venue around the corner, he'd be like, oh, didn't see that coming. But if his parents were like, the WHO are performing in the living room, he would be like, oh my God, that's crazy, I can't believe it. He would be more surprised to learn that the WHO would perform in his living room than he would be to learn that he could see the concert without taking the drive. So that's sort of an intuitive way to get onto this idea of viability. The less viable candidates for actuality are the ones that you would be more surprised to learn about. All right, so let's step back and just think again about what our strategy is here. We're trying to allow certain modal bases, but disallow others. We want to allow A1, but disallow A2. And this viability answer allows us to distinguish those. But those aren't the only ones that we want to distinguish. We also want to distinguish between Al seeing the concert and not taking the drive, and Joe being cured by antibiotics, So what we need, in order to distinguish these cases, is to say, roughly, that Al would be less surprised to learn that he could see the concert without taking the drive than Joe would be to learn that she could be cured with antibiotics. That's the way to test that. The hope being that worlds where she's cured by antibiotics are less viable candidates for actuality. There's just no reason to think that's the case, though. We just stipulate, it's perfectly plausible, that the latest medical research rolls in, and the doctors say, like, no, we did all these studies. Your disease can be cured by antibiotics. She'd be like, All right. I mean, I didn't think that was possible, but I guess it is. Whereas, you know, there might be no venues around the corner. The clearest place where the Who would ever play is 200 miles away. So we can just build the details into the case to prevent this viability answer from distinguishing the modal bases that we want from the modal bases that we don't. Is that about it? Cool. Thanks.
Right? Questions?
You want
to? Yeah. Do you want to jump in? Yes.
Susanna?
So thank you. I really enjoyed that. And two questions. One is, it strikes me this is the kind of framework that could easily generalize to other mental states that might be incompatible, you know, such as, or in conflict, you know, such as, you know, intentions or hopes and other mental states. So I wanted to invite you to say a bit more about this, the degree to which you think is generalizable to those other mental states. And the second independent question is, so it's often thought that agents or subjects who have conflicting mental states are somehow less rational than agents who don't have conflicting mental states. And that always strikes me as just wrong. Like on face of it, it seems obvious why one might think so. But then if you, you know, consider Al, there's nothing irrational about him. He just, you know, has beliefs that go in different directions. And so we obviously this kind of goes beyond your talk here, but if you can say something about how, you know, your model here could be exploited to give an account or point to an account that allows one to show why agents aren't rational, even though they have, you know, conflicting and even strongly conflicting hopes and desires and beliefs.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think actually the answer to the second question helps us distinguish the first. So I think that there is a certain class of attitudes that it's really hard to sort of pin irrationality on the agent for having conflicting attitudes towards the same proposition. I think hope is like that, wishing is like that, being glad is like that, wanting is like that. I do think that those are importantly,
I missed the verb. What was the verb you used? So it's hard to.
Okay, yeah, no. So the thought is that there's a certain class of propositional attitudes, wanting, hoping, wishing, being glad that, where if you hold those attitudes, both towards a proposition and not, or towards a proposition and its negation, or towards a proposition and its belief negation, it's not irrational. And it's clearly not irrational in these cases. I do think that there is a line between those cases and things like belief and intention, where sort of, if Al says, I intend to go to the concert, and I also don't intend to go to the concert, you can sort of like push on him. It's like, well, what are you going to do? This just doesn't make sense. And similarly, for when you were to push him on him saying, I believe I'm going to go to the concert, and I believe I'm not. It looks like that really is a different kind of conflict than ones with, you know, wishing and being glad about and wanting. There is a kind of wanting, though, that looks more like intending, which you might think of as all things considered wanting. What do you want to do, all things considered? Well, the case as I described it is one where Al doesn't, all things considered, want to go to the concert. He, all things considered, doesn't want to take the drive, even though, in another sense, he does want to take the concert. So there's a class of wanting that I think is something that approaches irrationality more if you've got conflicting attitudes towards it.
So I hear what you're saying. That makes a lot of sense. But of course, one can sort of quite easily translate the desires into beliefs. You know, so Al might have the belief, I believe I would like to go to the concert, and I believe I would like not to take the long ride, the long car ride, you know?
Yeah.
So those beliefs are.
Right. Yeah, so I think what's going to happen there is that these sentences, so we can get a true reading in this case of Al doesn't want to go to the concert. So, you know, his parents could say, I guess you don't want to go then if you're not willing to get in the car. And he'd be like, yeah, I don't. So what gives? It looks like he believes both that he wants to go and he believes that he doesn't want to go. And I think the answer is basically that want is context sensitive. So when we ascribe these beliefs to him, there's a context shift in the desire part. I mean, maybe the belief part too. But at the very least, there's a difference in the desire part. And that difference is a difference in which information state, basically which modal base the desire description is being evaluated with respect to.
And so, okay, so good. And so that would be a way of saying, okay, so the beliefs are incompatible, but there's nothing irrational about him despite these incompatible beliefs because of the context shift in the desire aspect of the belief.
Right, the thought would be that the beliefs themselves are actually not incompatible because the beliefs, because take the desire descriptions. When you have the context shift, the two sort of sentences actually express different propositions. So his beliefs attitudes are towards different propositions, yeah.
But as sentences, they're compatible as propositions, they are.
Exactly, exactly, yeah.
I wondered, in the extended version of your paper, on page 4, you write,
oh, Jesus.
In semantics, or want, should allow for conflicting desire ascriptions.
Yes.
In our specific case, we need to predict, blah, blah, blah. Now, normally, when we do semantics, sometimes we want to do a descriptive thing.
Yep.
Unfortunately, even though a descriptive intention for the semantics will demand that we allow for conflicting desire descriptions because they're a fact of life,
yep.
There's no uniform relation between beliefs and desires.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, beliefs influence desires,
mm-hmm.
but not in any systematic way. So I don't see how we're going to get any predictive power from a descriptive kind of semantics.
Mm-hmm.
And the other traditional way, that is a normative kind of semantics, is even worse. Because it doesn't help what Al really does or feels or wants. So what traditional semantics do you have that will require to actually predict what happens in real life about a phenomenon that has no systematic harmonic relation between the different factors.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like the moral that we should get from here is we should not try to get one.
Just give it up, yeah.
It is it's a red herring trying to find somehow to make a find the way that we can find a structure that will do this work for us. Let's just recognize that it's a psychological problem if we want to predict psychological states.
That's right. Yeah. Okay. So two thoughts. One, sort of like as I started saying at the beginning, this is about desire descriptions, and the project is one for natural language at this stage. So there is a question of, why worry about the psychology, basically? Let's just get the right predictions. I'll just get to that in 1 second. I do think that there is an interesting philosophical question that has to do with philosophy of mind and has to do with what's rational to desire and believe. And we've got this sort of paradigm notion that we can understand rational agents by ascribing to them desires and ascribing them to beliefs and predicting their action, or taking two of these things and working backwards to another. So this is an important notion sort of independently of the semantics. And the approach of a semantics that looks at belief is giving us an angle into that. Okay, but let's just go back to your question about, we're just, if the game here is just natural language semantics, so who cares about the psychology? There are two things to say. The first thing is that this style of semantics, this deontic modal style of semantics, where you have something like a set of worlds and then a ranking on those worlds, has proven to be empirically robust for modals, for example. This is, except basically people who are like expressivists about deontic modals, everybody thinks that this is effectively the right structure for how to model things that look like necessity modals, okay? So that's prima facie empirical reason to work within this framework. We know, for example, how modals or of this type embed under other modals. We know how they embed under conditionals. So that's a reason to go down this path of using this structure. All right, but that's not yet to say why use beliefs in this structure. That's just to say we want the structure in the first place. The answer is that if we don't say what the modal base is, we're not going to make predictions. It's not going to be a predictive view, even descriptively. So we need to say something about what it is. And if we start just like with a sort of a more commonsensical picture of what's going on, that's a good place to start. It looks like belief is where the action is. So it's a good place to start. And in fact, I think belief is ultimately where the action is, that we are going to abstract away from certain beliefs and not others in the cases where we have conflicting desires. And then these other cases where you want things that you believe that you will, that will happen or won't happen, it's our counterfactual or conditional beliefs that matter. So I believe that the project of using the beliefs in some ways to constrain or construct the modal base actually is one that can work. I mean, tell you more later. I can see you're skeptical, but I can tell you more, yeah.
All right, is there any more questions? Then I have one question. I'm wondering if you can say a bit more about why do you like this view that uses partial desire orderings? Mm-hmm. If I understood, the problem is that it overgenerates. So according to you, there will be a reading of all ones to take the drive. Yep. That is true, and there is just no such reading.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, what if we, I don't really know anything about these views, I'm just thinking how to get around this problem. So what if we have all these partial desired orderings and also the total desired ordering?
Yeah.
And say, well, there is this notion of wanting that P simpliciter, yep, and that's true only if you want that P relative to the total desired ordering. And then, according to this view, it's true that there is no reading of how one to take the drive simpliciter. And there is this reading of how one to take the ride relative to an ordering. Yep. That is true. But you know, all that means is if you forget all about how much he hates cars and getting sick and all that, yeah, he wants to take the drive, yeah, because he really wants to go to the concert. I mean, that doesn't seem horrible to me. It's, yeah, not something we'll normally say, but you know, sounds correct. Yeah. So what would be wrong with this?
Yeah, so what's wrong with just saying, so if you just say off the bat, Al wants to take the drive, that doesn't look so good. He takes the drive, he's begging, doesn't want to take the drive, we know that. He's also begging to not go, so he doesn't, all things considered, want to take the drive. But isn't there a sense in which, yeah, I mean, insofar as he wants to go to the concert, he wants to take the drive. That's a thought.
That's something we could express in English.
Exactly.
That would be that reading.
Right. And so, in fact, on this thought, the multiple ordering source view doesn't overgenerate, would be the claim. So I agree. I think that this sort of, this claim about how wanting to take the drive is the least sort of like robust intuition that I'm relying on in the paper. I think these things about like the wanting to take antibiotics or whatever are much, much stronger. But I think you can get yourself into maybe a frame of mind where you can hear a true reading of the sentence. So I don't actually feel particularly strongly either way. I do think that is not quite right. I do think that there is something important to distinguish these cases where it really isn't worth it for him, in that it's not just that he doesn't want to do it, all things considered. That they're basically, that we don't sort of want to do everything that we sort of believe to be coextensive with something else. And I think we can see this better in another kind of case of conflicting desires. So it's one of the, at the beginning of the talk. So I want to have pizza. I believe that I'll get heartburn if and only if I have pizza. All right, what do we need? Well, we need multiple ordering sources. We're going to give one that gives I want pizza a true reading. Yeah. So the multiple ordering source view with no further constraints is going to predict also a true reading of I want to have heartburn. We just apply that ordering source to that sentence. And in these cases, sort of, where the things that are believed to be coextensive are not means to a good end, but rather bad consequences of something that we think are good, it's not so clear to me that you can say something. So we've got on the one hand, can't we say, insofar as he wants to see the concert, doesn't he want to take the drive? I can get on board with that a little bit, but I think it's much harder to hear the reading in this other case. Insofar as you want to eat pizza, don't you want heartburn? No, I just don't want heartburn. Anyway. So I do think that these intuitions are weaker, but I do think that they are, I think they're, it's, they're not flimsy.
Yeah. Just one more thing. If I were to defend this view, I would tend to say, you know, the default view is I want that P is implicit relative to the total desire order. Uh-huh. And if one was to switch to the other readings, there has to be a lot of work. You have to do a lot of, you know, setting up and all that, and then you can express those things that in that context they don't sound that weird at all.
I think that's right. My thought basically is that it's going to be basically impossible to get yourself into a context where you're said to want heartburn, but that's contestable. Yeah.
I think that with enough background, doesn't sound crazy to me. But
yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Any more questions?
It is really floating idea, nothing very concrete. But one thing has been kind of been prompting me recently about context sensitivity is a matter of asking questions. So, what is L1 if you want to see the replay? So that's one way of restricting the model base to just, you know, mapping the answer to the question, what does he want?
Yeah.
To the concert. And that kind of eliminates everything else. So then you can also restrict, you know, what does L want if he doesn't want to take the drive to go to the concert?
Yeah.
That kind of restricts that
Modal
base. Have you considered that idea?
Yeah. So a version of that is my view. But a simple version of that doesn't work. So how do we implement question sensitivity? Well, we induce a partition on some set of worlds, right? And the answers to the question are just the cells of the partition. What is the set that we induce the partition on? Well, if the set is just the belief set, and we have this question, seeing the concert versus not, that is the same question as not taking the drive versus taking it. Because you're partitioning the same set, and you're partitioning it on the exact line that he believes separates concert plus drive from no concert plus no drive. Yeah. So my thought is basically what we want to do is we want to step back. We want to look at the total space of worlds, and we want to partition on that. So what that will allow us to do is it will allow us to break coextensions within the agent's belief set. But then if we ask the right questions, basically questions that are fine-grained but not too fine-grained, then we can use question sensitivity to answer, to distinguish conflicting desire descriptions. But one thing that is important is that the nature of these questions have to be much more fine-grained than sort of these thoughts about questions that are driving modeling conversation. Because when we're modeling conversation, the general idea is just like, we're trying to distinguish between two or three propositions. You know, we've got some goal and we need to carve up the space and then choose among them. But our desires are sensitive to so much more information than just this rather than that. I mean, this is partly the guiding thought behind we want to use the beliefs in the first place, because just sort of like a bare proposition, does he want to go to the concert? Well, he only wants to go because he believes that the Who are playing and that it will be so loud and they will play his favorite songs and blah, 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 blah. He believes it's a very particular kind of concert. So these questions that we have to ask need to be actually much more fine-grained than sort of like the question under discussion that is like sort of motivated, the sort of the kind of contextualism that is in, you know, belief descriptions or knowledge descriptions or just modeling conversation more generally. Yeah. Does that?
Yeah. Can I ask, first impression that will already embed kind of the restriction you want to get the interpretation that you need. So it seemed like a basic principle that would make this question fine-grained, already give you the answer that you want to begin with. So that's just my first impression of what you were saying. Is that something you deal with?
Can you just say that again?
Yeah, sorry. So it'd be something like you say, well, we need to restrict this a bit
first. Yep.
And so we need to ask questions that kind of partition, in a way that really sets us down and restricts those things that we don't want.
Yep.
That seems terribly ad hoc to me on Facebook. So is that something you have to deal with?
That's right. Okay. So here's what I'm saying. You don't want to take a partition on all of logical space that has just two answers, because what we want is sensitive to so much information. But you don't want to go to the other extreme either, because if what's under question is every single proposition, then you're just going to be left with the belief set, basically. So we have a similar problem of trying to find a middle ground. How do we allow the right size question without allowing the tiny one that's not going to allow them to conflict and the huge one that's going to just have nothing to do with what we desire? And my basic thought is that the type of question relative framework that I think is right, the reason that it's good is that it allows us to give principled answers. That is the benefit of going with these coarser grain possibilities, or going with these possibilities that are responsive to questions, is that unlike the beyond belief modal base constraint, and in fact, I think unlike the variable ordering source view, even when you do admit of these readings that I'm claiming aren't there, finding sort of like the sweet spot with these questions allows us to explain, basically, allows us to give a principle by which we distinguish the ones that are too big from the ones that are too small.
Any other questions? All right. Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So I guess that's one of the float that sort of makes alternative proposal.
Yeah.
That you maybe already thought about, but maybe something presuppositionally is going on here.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe like when we say Al wants to see the concert, what's going on is some sort of he's accepting the concert to tend to promote his interest in some way. Maybe he believes that this particular concert will promote his concert-related interests or something like that. And then what goes on when we look at two, when he doesn't want to take the drive, he sort of accepts the driving, is it the sort of thing that promotes his interest in some way, but and then believes that driving in this particular occasion won't promote my driving-related interest or something. Then maybe that gets what we want.
So what is the, right, so we've got some sort of we've got some parameter that's tracking what he accepts. Can you just say, I mean, I know it's just basic idea. Yeah.
Maybe he accepts that concerts are the sorts of thing that promotes his interests in some way.
Yeah.
That seems okay, right?
Yeah.
Believes that going to see this concert and promote his interests.
Yeah.
Of this particular concert.
Yeah.
And then we say the same thing with two, we say that. Doesn't want to drive, so we know that he accepts the driving doesn't promote his interests.
Yeah.
And that driving on this particular occasion won't, I don't know, something like, I'm not really sure how to flesh this out, but it's something wrong with you.
Right. Yeah. So the tricky thing, I think, is going to be distinguishing the cases where sort of the general cases from the specific. Because what we want in many cases, so if like we all things considered want some end, there might be all sorts of like weird things that we believe that we have to do to get them. And so insofar as we sort of, at least we can get ourselves into a mindset where you sort of all things considered want any means to an end, you can all things considered want these sort of weirder things that in general aren't conducive to the value that you're trying to promote. I'm not sure if that sort of, okay, yeah.
Just can I ask one more thing? So you said during the talk that you have some objections to a contextualist kind of way of getting around this problem. So I was thinking David Lewis's semantics for nouns, right? If the standards are low, you get to say I know I have hands.
Yep.
And relative to that context, it's true that you know that you're not a brain in the bat, but as soon as you said it, that kind of move suggests itself pretty obviously, right? So I can say I want to go to the concert. That makes it so that the context is one that only one ordering is relevant. And relative to that, it's true that he wants to take the car, right? But it's not something one can say because that switches the context.
That's right.
So then that would be a way of capturing intuition.
That's exactly right. So. Yeah. So my thought, basically, I've tried to explore some options for what would trigger that context shift. So we've got, like in the Lewis case, we've got something that's obvious. You bring to salience some possibility that before was properly ignored. And then, so that's added to the standard, so your context has shifted. So we've got other things like this too, like with Sobel sequences and counterfactuals, where what forces a context shift? Well, you get some sort of domain expansion. Basically, once you add worlds, you can't go back. You know, it's just like the kind of thing where once you expand basically any domain in natural language, it looks like you can't contract. It's hard to contract. And these types of maneuvers, I just haven't figured out, just haven't been able to develop a principled story that looks like those.
So what about desires? I mean, if Al says, I want to go to the concert, he makes the desire to see the Who very salient. And then if he says, I don't want to take the car, right?
Yeah.
That maybe that triggers some sort of accommodation, so that now the other desire,
right,
not to get sick, is the relevant one. And then with that kind of accommodation, you can go back and forth.
Right, yeah. So I just want to spot the multiple ordering source view, the idea that you can go back and forth between the concert promoting one and the not sickness promoting one. Just going to spot that. By some mechanism, you get that shift. What I'm worried about is, let's go back to assuming what sort of you are worried that you were sort of denying before, which I'm sort of not super strong on, that there is no true reading of how Al wants to take the drive. So what this contextualist story needs to say is that there is a mechanism that like forces the context shift, that you cannot hold it fixed. The question is, what would that mechanism be? In the case of knowledge, it looks like there's a straightforward mechanism that actually forces you away. It's one thing to sort of, you know, wave your hand a little bit and say, you know, like, we're trying to accommodate. We're trying to, you know, make what you say true. But, and so, you know, we're able to sort of flip back and forth. But then the question is, why can't you force yourself to stick? Once we've stuck ourselves in the context that's promoting the hearing good music, we need a story that does not allow you to stick in that context to evaluate how Al wants to take the drive, at least assuming that you don't think that that has a true reading. Now, I completely agree. If you think that you can get a true reading of that sentence, then I'm not so worried about sort of like a lack of a concrete story about how to get there.
My suspicion is that something like the rule of attention will do.
Because it seems like when you say I don't want to take the car ride, you're drawing attention to a particular desire, just like when you say something about brains in the bag.
Yeah.
You draw attention to the possibility that you're not bringing the bag. Yeah. But of course the details are missing. Right?
Yeah, I mean, just one quick thought on that. You can mention both things in the same breath. You can say, I don't want to take the drive, even though I could see the concert, and boy, would the concert be great. But you can't say, I have hands, even though, you know, and then say something about the possibility of the matrix. Anyway, that's just one difference, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Thanks again, that was fantastic.
I even like your paper call.